So today is the last lecture, and maybe it will last less than 2 hours. So I'm very pleased that one of the problems which I stated in the first lecture has already been solved by master student from Keio University, master student of Professor Masato Kurihara. So I hope that some students from Kyoto University will solve some of exercises as well. And if you solve, then please tell me. And another thing is that all these things which I'm discussing in these lectures, most of them form part of my work, and in particular what I'm talking today, on Wednesday, it's part of my work during the last 17 years. And when I started in 2001, then I had several PhD students at that time, and in particular, one of them during this period was Kocher Birkara. He works in birational geometry. So, of course, it is really nice that he was awarded the Fields Medal. So he knows a lot of this stuff which I'm talking about, and we have projects for the future. So now I'll go back where I stopped on Wednesday, and I was basically discussing two-dimensional local reciprocity map and class field theory. And so from structural point of view, it's really amazing that exactly the same formulas work fine. So the situation there was like, remember, topological K2T is very important. So in the local theory. So we're working with this, replace the multiplicative group of one-dimensional local field by something like this. The difference with the one-dimensional case is that we do not have full information about this object. In positive characteristic, we do. We know this object in terms of its topological generators and relations. In characteristic zero, we do not have full information, but only some partial information. And this is in some sense a problem, but still we have class field theory. So, as I already mentioned last time, we have a two-dimensional local reciprocity map, which is very, very similar to, in its shape, to the one-dimensional reciprocity map. Even so now, it's applied to more sophisticated objects than in dimension one because of K2 and two-dimensional local field structure. So this is a beautiful formula which just expresses the substance of two-dimensional local class field theory. And pi sigma is just, well, as I said, sigma is the fixed field of some Galois automorphism whose restriction on L gives sigma and whose restriction on some analog of maximal unramified extension, which in this case is purely unramified extension, is positive power of the Frobenius of that extension. And pi sigma is an element of K2T sigma, which goes with respect to the composite of two boundary maps in K-theory to 1. So pi sigma goes to 1. K1 is always Z. K1 of a field. This will be K1 of the residue field. So it should go to 1. So it's analog of prime element. For usual one-dimensional fields, prime element goes to 1 with respect to discrete valuation. But in this case, we start with K2, so we have to apply the composite of 2. And then there are some open problems. In particular, I mentioned one of them last time about the explicit description of the maximal extension where a fixed prime element in K2T is a universal norm. It's still open because there is no theory of Lubin-Tate groups over two-dimensional local fields. There is no higher-dimensional Lubin-Tate theory, which is interesting. Another open problem is to relate class field theory with ramification theory, but there is no ramification theory yet. There are six different approaches to high ramification theory, but none of them is satisfactory. They all have their positive things and drawbacks. We still don't understand really even two-dimensional local ramification theory. So this is just a reciprocity map, but then we have existence theory. And in order to prove existence theorem, we need to use some additional information about K2. And so this additional information comes from some hugely important commutative diagram. So this field F, it has its ring of integers of rank 1 and its ring of integers of rank 2. And here is an important commutative diagram. I will explain the meaning of this diagram in a moment. So what we want to understand better this group, because after all, it plays such important role in class field theory. And generally, this group is generated by symbols. So generally, it's not true that every element of K2 or K2T is a symbol. In general, an arbitrary element is a finite sum of symbols. And we want to have as few terms in such finite sums as possible. So for two-dimensional local fields, what we can achieve, we can represent every element of this group as the sum of not more than two terms. Not more than two terms. So if we choose local parameters T2 and T1, everything here will depend on the choice of local parameters. If we choose such local parameters, then we can consider a map from here to here, which so here, remember that the structure, multiplicative structure is like this is isomorphic to this times the cyclic group generated by T2. And this group of units is isomorphic to this group of units times the cyclic group generated by T1. So we can write every element of this as some integer power of T1 times a unit. And similarly here. So UV will be units with respect to rank 2 integral structure. So the map is then the following. So this goes to I plus J T1 T2 plus T1 U1 plus U2 T2. So here you can say I have three terms, not two. But of course, what I can do, I can say that this is the same as, for example, T1 to the power of I plus J times U2 T2 and then plus T1 U1. So now I have two terms. So the main point is that every element of this group can be written as the sum of a symbol where the second element is T2, and then a symbol where the first element is T1. So this is the main point. So then, if you have elements of this group represented like this, it's very easy to see what is the sum of two such elements of K2T, because you only need to multiply the first components and the second components whereas T2 will always be T2, T1 will always be T1. So this really makes simplifications, makes huge simplifications in computations. And in particular, so this homomorphism is actually surjective. This can be proved using topological considerations. So then we can say that this group is actually covered by K1 times K1, because this is just multiplicative group. K1 times K1 applied to all. So this is important because instead of working with some unknown, fully not fully known group like this, we can just move all computations to the level of the standard multiplicative group of some local object. So then, of course, all computations will be much easier. And this is exactly what will happen when we go to the zeta integral. Of course, you lose some information because the kernel is non-trivial. But as far as the unramified theory is concerned, in other words, units, then you lose no information. So this is surjective homomorphism. And what is this? This is a symbol map. Or, in fact, a minus symbol map, because I use slightly different normalization here. So the symbol map. So it sends a pair to the symbol which has these two elements as its components. So this is the symbol map, which is difficult to work explicitly with. And then the main point is that there is a continuous vertical map, which I can denote by something like lambda, for example. There is a continuous vertical map lambda, which makes this diagram commutative. So there is a continuous map from here to there, so that this diagram is commutative. So I can, of course, rephrase just what I said in a slightly better way. And to rephrase it in a better way, almost equivalently what I just said can be rephrased in the following way, that every symbol like alpha beta can be written as the sum of two symbols like this and this. In K2TF, in K2TF. By the way, if I remove T, then this is not true. It's fundamental that this is K2T, not K2. So every symbol can be written like this and this, with continue with functions delta and epsilon, which continuously depend on alpha and beta. So these functions delta and epsilon exactly give us the map lambda, because then this, like delta will be the first component of the map lambda and epsilon will be the second. So this is very useful property, rearranging things and representing them in a different shape. So this property is used to prove existence theorem. In existence theorem, you need to know norm groups. You need to make explicit computations at least for cyclic extensions of prime degree, what their norm groups are. This is not easy. You really need to go inside arithmetic and do concrete computations. It's not easy. And especially because K2T is also not quite easy. But using this commutative diagram and this representation, we can make all the computations, and then we have the proof, or several proofs, of the existence theorem. So the existence theorem is, of course, that open subgroups of finite index. Not every open subgroup is of finite index in dimension 2. So open subgroups of finite index in K2TF are in one-to-one correspondence with finite abelian extensions of F. And in particular, for finite abelian extension, the corresponding open subgroup is its norm group. So this is the existence theorem. And it takes some effort to prove it. But using this commutative diagram really helps. Now I'll go to the local zeta integral, to two-dimensional local zeta integral. So first of all, we will need to work with the multiplicative structure. So I explained measure on the additive group. On the multiplicative group, we also need the product of two copies of the multiplicative group. So by definition, this measure will be just with some normalization factor, as usual, when you go to the multiplicative case. So this will be just the measure on F times F. I explained what the measure on F is. The measure on F times F is just the tensor product of those two measures, divided by the module function. This is module function. So module function is associated to every translation invariant measure, and by definition, the module function of A is just the measure of something like this divided by the measure of this for any measurable set A, assuming that the denominator is not zero. Then for every translation invariant measure, this, the right-hand side doesn't depend on the choice of A, and so this function is well defined. So in this case, it will be F times F. So this is a multiplicative measure, and then the local zeta integral is defined for some function like analog of so-called Brewer-Schwarz function, but well, the name does not matter. And I will denote this homomorphism by Gothic letter T, which I write like this. So this is the local zeta integral. So F is something like a tensor product of, well, in this case, you don't need characteristic. So it's like characteristic function, for example, of Oxz times Oxz. Or you can replace each of these by any other principal submodule or submodule. Because I don't have Xz, then this will be just O. So this will be just like this. So it's a standard thing, integral structure. So the integration goes over this times this. And we have this homomorphism, surjective homomorphism. So when we apply this surjective homomorphism to elements of this, tau Gothic T at X is an element of K2TF. And then, so this is K2TF, and maybe I can put here this sign to distinguish from this. So what is this? So this is a map from K2TF, which is closely related to the map I just used in the description of class field theory. So this map is just, it sends prime element, for example, to Q inverse. And then it sends multiple of prime element to Q to the power of minus n, and any unit does not change the answer. So it's related to that map which I had for class field theory 5 minutes ago. But it's just, it's multiplicative version. You raise Q to that power. So this is like related to class field theory, similar to one-dimensional case. This is like Brewer-Schwarz function. So we're mixing additive integral structures with class field theoretical structures, and we use translation invariant measure integration on the multiplicative groups. So for example, of course, you are interested to know what is some partial example. So for example, this will give us the Euler factor, like this. So please note that now we have square, because we have two copies. Because of two copies, we, instead of first power, we have the second power. But it's just the Euler factor, so exactly what we're supposed to, or what we want to get. So in this theory of local zeta integral, there is also a local functional equation. Local functional equation, which is similar to, well, not similar, but generalization of local functional equation in Tate series. So this local functional equation says that for two nice functions f and g, this thing, provided the denominators are not zero, does not depend on the choice of Brewer-Schwarz function. So it's exactly the same as what we have in dimension one. So the quotient of zeta integral for f and for Fourier transform of f, I talked about Fourier transform last time, but at 2 minus s, it's important to replace s with 2 minus s. It does not depend, so does not depend on the choice of this additive function f. So here I took f like centrally normalized, but nothing prevents one changing it, like taking characteristic function of some other measurable sets. And then still the answer doesn't change. So this is very nice. Locally, we have a lot of analogies with the one-dimensional series. There are some open questions like local root numbers, but I don't have time to discuss them. Okay. And so now the global theory. As you can imagine, the global theory will be kind of more complicated, but there are many features of the global theory which are kind of just global analog of the local theory. So I now go to the global theory.
Sorry.
Yes?
When f is a characteristic function, O times O,
yes. Yes. So, of course, it depends how you normalize Fourier transform. So here, similar to one-dimensional theory, there is this issue that first of all, you use a character, choose a character. Depending on this character, you can, for example, choose measure which is self-dual with respect to the character. And you can also choose Fourier transform, which is more compatible with the choice of that character. But assuming that, for example, the character has conductor O, if it has conductor O, then the Fourier transform of this function will be exactly itself. This is very important for the global theory, because this property means that you can define global Fourier transform, which locally is almost always the identity map. So, yeah, but so it's, of course, an expected property. So now I'll go to the global theory. And so the global theory will be more complicated than in dimension one, because it's two-dimensional global theory. It's not one-dimensional global theory. And also, it's global theory, not local theory. So first of all, a surprising fact is that, first of all, there are two different adelic structures. They fundamentally different from each other. In dimension one, we never meet this situation that there are two completely different adelic structures on one-dimensional objects. In dimension two, we have this situation. One adelic structure is geometric adelics, which I already started to talk about some time ago. So it's more related to devices and one cocycles. It's geometric adelics. And another structure, what I call analytic adelics or arithmetic adelics, this will be related to zeta function, to integration, to zero cycles. So zero cycles completely different from devices on surfaces. Very deep conjectures like BSD is about relation, in fact, about certain invariants related to devices and closed points on arithmetic surfaces. So it's not a miracle that there are two different adelic structures. So these two adelic structures kind of lift some geometrical things and some analytical things to complete level. Adels are complete objects, to objects where you have some dualities. So we will have also two dualities. One duality for geometrical adels, additive group, and another duality for analytical adels. So these dualities will be very different from each other. So two dualities, not one, but two, because it's dimension two. And so in some sense, one, it's not enough to develop one of these two series. You need both. So let me start with adelic geometry. So I will start with geometric adels. This is easier. This is easier. And well, I don't want to go into the history, but there were some open problems in this two-dimensional adelic geometry, like for 30 years. And there were some fundamental mistakes in some original first papers on this topic. But anyway, I don't want to go into the history. I just would like to define the main objects here. So first of all, I already talked, when I talked about local two-dimensional fields, I mentioned that this diagram, so this is two-dimensional local field. When we look at two-dimensional objects geometrically originating from a surface, then we get this picture. So analog of this picture, adelic analog of this picture will be A, B, C, and K. So this is adelic version of this local picture. I now need to introduce for you these adelic objects. Because we are in dimension two, these adelic objects are kind of double restricted product. Not once, but twice. But I will give a presentation which kind of simplifies things and then is easier to understand. I also, for simplicity, I just give the definitions in equal characteristic case, like in positive characteristic. But all this can be extended to arbitrary characteristic. So how do we define A? So this is the most important adelic object. We start with a curve Y on the surface S, irreducible curve Y on the surface S. And for this curve, I will define AY. This will be not one-dimensional adelic object associated to one-dimensional curve, but it will be a two-dimensional adelic object which knows a little bit how this curve sits on the surface. So it's more than just one-dimensional object. But so I will put this like this because in mixed characteristic you need to modify the definition. In equal characteristic, this is precise definition. So what we do, take the function field of the curve. This is one-dimensional global field. Consider its usual adels from one-dimensional theory. So these are usual adels from one-dimensional theory of the one-dimensional global field. And then add formal power series in one variable, where Ty is like a local equation of Y on S. So formal power series in one variable over one-dimensional adelic object. So obviously, this makes it a two-dimensional object. So it sounds like a quite a reasonable definition. And obviously, we can also consider integral structure of rank one here, just working with integral power series. So these are power series. These are integral power series. And then A, the full adelic space A, by definition, is the restricted product for all curves on S of AY with respect to all AY. So in other words, this is the restricted product. So it's usually denoted with prime sign here. Maybe this is a little large for a prime sign. So what does it mean? Restricted product means the following, that this is the infinite product. All components belong to AY, And almost all, in other words, all except finitely many, belong to this. So this is the restricted product. So it's in spirit, like quite similar to the definition of Adele's in the classical situation. But these are two-dimensional objects, so things actually get really more complicated. And also I can define kind of integral structure inside these Adele's just by taking the product of all OAY. So I have Adele's, geometric Adele's, and I have something integral of rank one inside Adele's. So maybe so far it looks like pretty reasonable and nothing especially difficult. And maybe it is so. So then B, by definition, will be the intersection of A with the product of all ky. So for each Q of y, I can take just this two-dimensional local global field associated to y, which was defined before. And then I just want to make this product of ky in Adelic sense. To make this product of ky in the Adelic sense, I just intersect with A in the product of all kxy. Or alternatively, I can say that I just use some restricted product, which I just don't explicitly define. So this is B. So B corresponds to all curves on the surface. And then C obviously will correspond to all points on the surface. And again, it can be viewed as a restricted product of Kx. So this completes the definition of the object on this geometric Adele's in dimension 2 picture. We will also have two analytic Adele's, but right now we work with geometric Adele's. So now if you like geometry, then there will be nice things. Because now, of course, it's one cocycle, so devices, so take any divisor on the surface and associate to it a subspace of the Adelic space, which by definition consists, well, it's the intersection of A with the product of such things. So in other words, I impose some restrictions on how negative powers of ty can be in at y component. So I'm asking that these negative powers start with this. So this or larger than this. So this will be a subspace of Adele's. And Adele's will be inductive limit of such subspaces. And then I can similarly define BD, and I can similarly define CD just by taking intersection of B and C with what I already defined. And then there is another complex, which was for the first time correctly defined in a 2-page paper by Sasha Bellinson a long time ago, like 1978 or something. So this two-dimensional Adelic complex is what? It is this is a three-term Adelic complex in degree 0, 1, and 2. So there will be associated H0, H1, H2 cohomologies. And the definition is, for example, here, if I take A, B, C, then it goes to something like A minus B, C minus A, B minus C. And this map is, of course, the sum. So this is an Adélie complex, and it's a two-dimensional version of the one-dimensional Adélie complex. One-dimensional Adélie complex, by the way, is much simpler, of course. It's just like this. This is one-dimensional complex on curves, just two terms. Of course, on surfaces, we have more terms. So cohomologies of this Adélie complex are exactly Zariski cohomologies associated to the device D on the surface S. So this, if I denote this Adélie complex by AD, then its cohomologies are exactly Zariski cohomologies associated to the device D, and moreover, you can extend it to quasi-coherent shifts if you especially interested in this kind of stuff. So you can define Adélie complex for quasi-coherent shifts, and so, but this is kind of a little boring. So anyway, I just would like to describe some basic things of this geometric Adélies, and I will just include everything in one single theorem. So the first property, geometric Adélies are self-dual. So one can define topology here because it's similar to what I did in the past. For example, we have topology on Adélies. Then, so this is inductive limit of projective limits of finite dimensional spaces over Adélies. Then you have topology here, similar to how I did with other objects before. Then on restricted products, you automatically have topology if you have topology on each term. So then you have topology on A, then you take induced topology on B and C. So there is topology here. I just don't discuss it because it's basically similar to the previous. So the first property is that Adélies are self-dual. Non-canonically, they are isomorphic to continuous homomorphisms from A to the unit circle, to the group of characters. So this is the additive group of Adélies. But they actually are rings, not only groups. And actually, this is non-canonical, and again, it depends on the choice of character, similar to other situations. Also, here there is a relation with, in positive characteristics, there is a relation with differential forms. If you choose a global differential form on the surface of a finite field, then it's easy to actually to get so-called trace of residue of differential form times components of Adélies. And this is very useful to for computations. The second property is that K is discrete in Adélies. This is an analog of one-dimensional property. And also K coincides with the intersection of B and C. And also the quotient of A by the sum of B and C is compact. So note that the quotient of A by K is not compact in dimension 2. In dimension 1, actually, this quotient is compact, but in dimension 1. But in dimension 2, it is this quotient which is compact. And of course, in dimension 1, global elements also discrete in Adélies, and this property is preserved in dimension 2. So also, if you choose appropriately a homomorphism, continuous homomorphism here, then the orthogonal complement of B will be B, and the, for example, you use global differential form, and the orthogonal complement of C will be C. So this is nice. Orthogonal complement with respect to some pairing associated to this self-duality, which uses differential form on the surface. And Also, with respect to this orthogonal complement, this subspace AD, its orthogonal complement will be the subspace associated to canonical divisor minus D. This is canonical divisor of the surface. And then the final property, which was an open problem for like 35 years, is adelic description of the intersection pairing. So for two divisors E and D, the intersection index can be computed purely in terms of this adelic complex. And the formula is this. You don't even need to know that cohomologies are Zariski cohomologies. So this is the formula. These are divisors, the sum of divisors E, D, and zero. This is Euler characteristic of this adelic complex. So the Euler characteristic is just, as usual, if we work over finite fields, then this is then the alternating sum of dimensions over finite field or over the ground field of these cohomologies, which will be finite dimensional vector spaces over the finite field. But you can, the same works if you go to surfaces over C. In fact, all this geometric adelic theory works for surfaces over any perfect field, not only over finite field. So anyway, this is adelic interpretation of the intersection pairing. So using this adelic interpretation, one can give a completely new proof of the Riemann-Roch theorem on surfaces, which from my point of view is much better than any of existing proofs, because it just basically uses adelic self-duality and how global elements sit inside adels and also all these other facts to deduce the Riemann-Roch theorem in a very natural way, whereas all existing proofs deduce the Riemann-Roch theorem in a very unnatural way, unfortunately. So the Riemann-Roch theorem, of course, will be, in this case, this formula. So this is two-dimensional Riemann-Roch theorem. So the Riemann-Roch theorem, of course, is fundamental importance for algebraic geometry. And it's nice that at least we can finally see its significance by using two-dimensional adelic structures and their self-duality. By the way, there is also so-called ser-duality for cohomologies. So ser-duality also, of course, follows from this duality. This duality is stronger than ser-duality, because ser-duality is just at the level of cohomologies, whereas here we have duality at the level of the ambient adelic space. Cohomology is just some linear algebra approximation to the full picture. So we have duality on the whole space, and of course it implies easily such things as ser-duality. So these are geometric adels. So I just talked basically in equal characteristic case, like surface over perfect field. For arithmetic surfaces, still some work needs to be done. It's actually being done currently by two students in Nottingham. For arithmetic surfaces, we need more. We need something additional. And so the problem, as usual, is with Archimedean data. So in other words, the problem is with the Rakelov geometry. So we need adelic interpretation of a Rakelov geometry on arithmetic surfaces. So we need to incorporate nicely Archimedean data by modifying these adelic complexes to become non-linear, to incorporate the Archimedean data. Also, we need to get an adelic description of the green function, which is a transcendental analytic object from differential geometry, which of course is involved in Arakelov geometry, and so we need such interpretation. This is already known, but this is being written down. And finally, instead of the proof of the Riemann-Roch theorem, this Adelic approach is supposed to give, and it will, give a new Adelic proof of the Faltings Riemann-Roch theorem on arithmetic surfaces. So obviously it's more complicated than just algebraic geometry in equal characteristic. But the advantage of Adelic is that, of course, if they work in all characteristics, in dimension one and dimension two. So just we need to wait a little before we have texts and papers published and so on. But this is more or less understood. Still, there are open problems, but more or less understood. Okay, so now I'll go to analytic Adels. So these are two-dimensional global theory geometric Adels. Now I go to analytic Adels. And you have to completely change to change how you think about things, because analytic Adels is completely different intuition. It's not geometric Adels, it's different. So now I go to analytic Adels. So the point is, why do we need analytic Adels? Well, first of all, we want to have some theory for zero cycles, not just for devices, but for zero cycles. Classical algebraic geometry does not tell much about zero cycles. It tells a lot about devices in the case of surfaces. Secondly, we want to be able to integrate. So there is, it's just a theorem, if you wish, or a meta-theorem. There is no non-trivial measure and integration. No non-trivial translation invariant measure and integration on geometric Adels. Various people were trying to find such measure and integration, even going into the world of derived geometry, but all this does not really work well to the extent to be applicable to zeta integrals. So, and it's not a miracle that there is no translation invariant measure integration, because it's geometric, they one cocycles, whereas zeta function is zero cycles. So remember, I was emphasizing the fact that we have two different integral structures. And zero cycles, they are like integral structure, correspond to integral structure of rank two. This corresponds to integral structure of rank one. These are completely different integral structures. So these Adelic analytic Adels, they will be like integral structure of rank two. Geometric Adels like integral structure of rank one only. So what are these analytic Adels? So surprisingly, they were invented only like 16 years ago. Geometric Adels like 50 years old, even though original definitions were incorrect. But analytic Adels like 15 years old. So, but I can define them in some looking easy to understand way, even though there are various things hidden there. So this will be also restricted product, but now of this, it will be now a restricted product of this integral geometric Adels, so integral power series in Ty, with respect to what? With respect to rank two integral structure on Ay. And rank two integral structure on Ay is what? It's basically similar how rank two integral structure is related to rank one integral structure on local objects. So I just have to make sure that the coefficient is integral. What does it mean to be integral for Adels? Just every component is integral. Well, we ignore Archimedean components for a while. So this then should be like this. And then you allow everything else as components, coefficients of higher degrees of the power of Ty. So this is the definition of integral structure of rank two. And what is this? It's just the product of all completed local ring when x runs through all points of curve. This is one-dimensional thing, just usual product of completed local rings. So by definition, this analytic adelphi is the restricted product of rank one integral structure with respect to rank two integral structure. So this is rank two integral structure, this is rank one integral structure. And still, it does not work like this. Still, one has to impose additional restriction. And the problem is that if you have a relative surface over one-dimensional base, so if you have a relative surface over one-dimensional base, then on this surface you will have fibers, so you will have vertical curves. You will have fibers, but then you have too many horizontal curves. You have too many horizontal curves because they will correspond to rational points of the generic fiber over all finite extensions of the field involved into the situation. So you will have too many horizontal curves. And you cannot really then, if you want to integrate, you know, you will have problem to make convergent the integral over infinitely many horizontal curves because there are too many of them. So you are forced to allow finitely many horizontal curves only. This is what you are forced to do. You cannot allow all horizontal curves because too many. Integrals will diverge. So this means that here y does not run through all irreducible curves on the surface, but y can be any vertical curve, any vertical irreducible curve, and finitely many horizontal. How many finitely depends on specific context. So, but not all. Here, curves run through all curves on the surface, which is important for the geometric theory. For this analytic adelphi, you cannot allow all horizontal curves, but only finitely many, but all vertical. With vertical, no problem. Closed points, each closed point will sit on some vertical curve. So you will count all closed points contribution to the zeta integral, but you cannot allow infinitely many horizontal curves because the integrals will diverge. So then this gives a definition, but you see this definition depends on the choice of finitely many horizontal curves, so it becomes less rigid as in dimension one. But this is just how it works. And then by definition, B is the intersection of A with the space B. So we have just two analytic adelphi objects, which are A and B. And as a group, A is a subgroup of geometric A, but the adelphic structures not in the induced one. The adelphic structure on analytic adelphi is not the induced adelphic structure from geometric adelphi. It's a different structure because rank two integral structure is not the okay, so now duality. Duality for analytic adelphi. We already had duality for geometric adelphi, so there is second duality for analytic adelphi. So this duality will be basically a lift of duality from one-dimensional thing, but for infinitely many curves involved. So here, first of all, we choose some centrally normalized characters on of one-dimensional adelphi. So choose centrally normalized in appropriate sense, centrally, so that the conductor is almost always O. Conductor is almost always OAKY, something like this, if possible. In fact, this is not possible, but approximately. I don't define this explicitly. And then lift these characters via residue map, projection map, to characters on OKY, OAY, because there is a projection map here, so you can just lift. This is the residue field of this, because there is surjective homomorphism from this ring to the constants, just associating to every power series its free term. So this will be a centrally normalized character there, and then choose psi as the tensor product. So this will be a certain character on A. So here various complications emerge, as you can imagine. One complication is like this. So you cannot really ensure that this character on adelic character has contact like this. So for example, imagine that we work with elliptic curve. And then, so this is adelic ring of elliptic curve. But then infinitely many points of this curve, the local conductor of this character will be different from O. And it's the same for other curves. And so the conductor will be actually not like this, but almost like this, but with finitely many points different, infinitely many points different from this. And then on for each curve, you have finitely many points deviation from this. But then here we involve infinitely many curves. So then you have infinitely many deviations on the whole surface. So this character is already kind of strange. It's not like in dimension one, if you work with characters, they only have non-trivial conductor, non-trivial in the sense different from O, integral structure, infinitely many points. This character will differ from, it will have conductor different from O in infinitely many points on the surface. And then if you think a little more about this, this will imply that A is not self-dual. Because of this phenomena. It's not self-dual. In dimension two, it's not self-dual. And more precisely, the dual object to A will be some kind of torso over the original A. It will just shift of A by some idel from the space, from geometric ideals. And this idel will have infinitely many non-trivial components. So this will be not isomorphic to A. But if you restrict on any subset of finitely many curves, then you still have self-duality. So self-duality only disappears in the limit when you go to infinitely many curves. And moreover, even though you don't have self-duality, you have reflexivity. The dual of the dual will be isomorphic to the original space. So still there is reflexivity, even though there is no self-duality. And so because of this phenomena, what computations with the zeta integral will do, they just, in order to compute something, you restrict on finitely many curves, you do computation on finitely many curves, and then you carefully check that when this set of finitely many curves tends to include all vertical curves, then things converge appropriately and give you the formula that you need. This is exactly how the theta formula in dimension two for analytic adels will be deduced. So I'm just explaining that there are some new phenomena in dimension two which we never see in dimension one. And also one can ask, what is the easiest curve, or what is the easiest generic fiber to work with? So it's not actually a projective line, it's actually elliptic curve. For elliptic curve, Euler characteristic of elliptic curve is zero. Of projective line, it's not zero. And the fact that it is zero will mean that certain factors, when you start to do computations, almost always equal to one for all vertical curves. And then the product will converge. But if you replace elliptic curve by projective curve or curve of high genus, then these factors will be almost always not equal to one. And then you have convergence problems. You have to renormalize things. We know how to do that. But the theory will be more complicated. So in fact, elliptic surfaces is kind of the easiest way to deal from the point of view of measure integration because more things converge naturally. So that's it. So now the measure on A, analytic adels, will be by definition the measure on tensor product of the measure on this. And the measure on this is basically just kind of a lift of the usual measure on adels, one-dimensional adels. So there are some complications here, but I just skip them. So anyway, we'll have a measure like this. So this is just the usual adelic measure. Of course, this also can be viewed as tensor product of all local measures involved in this construction. And so we'll have now a measure. And then we also have Fourier transform, a global Fourier transform, which will be defined by exactly the same formula. And for some centrally normalized functions, like characteristic function of integral structure with itself, this will Fourier transform will be very nicely related to, again, to characteristic function of O with O. So this will work fine. And then, so I'm almost ready to define global zeta integral, but for global zeta integral, I need an adelic version of that diagram which I used for the local theory. So remember, for the local theory, what we had something like this. I now already switched to the notation like kxz. It's two-dimensional fields. So for the local theory, we had that commutative diagram. I emphasized it's very important for explicit class field theory and for the existence theory. So we had such a diagram for the local theory. So that was local diagram. And then we can pass to its adelic version. So its adelic version is very natural. It's just like this. So it's an adelic version of that diagram. So because these were different kind of structures, here we'll have adelis, geometric adelis, multiplicative group, mixed with analytic adelis, multiplicative group. And the zeta integral will live here. Similar, like local zeta integral lives here, adelic zeta integral will live here. But there will be some information coming into this area on which you integrate the local zeta integral, which will involve geometric adelis information. So this is very important. Certain information about the structure of the space comes via this continuous map, which is adelic version of this continuous map, from some kind of non-trivial interaction between geometric adelis and analytic adelis. And this is the symbol map in K-theory. And from here, we had a reciprocity map to the maximal abelian extension of Kxz. And here we have global class field theory. We have reciprocity map to the maximal abelian extension of K. This is two-dimensional global class field theory. It has a huge kernel. And also, we'll need a restriction of this diagram on B, on spaces B. So this is for A. But by some reason, which will become clear soon, we need restriction of this to spaces B. And if you want to restrict on B, you also have to factorize by units because otherwise it won't work. So the restriction on B will be like B modulo units and here this space, other space B. And then this times this, and then K to TB. So K to TB actually is in the kernel of the reciprocity map. So anyway, this is just a Adelic version of those local integrals of the local diagrams. So now I can define the global zeta integral and then start discussing what we know about it. Okay, so now really the main object in this series of lectures, two-dimensional zeta integral. So its definition really uses a lot of the previous things. And it is an integral over the multiplicative group of two copies of analytic Adels. And then like Adelic two-dimensional Breuer-Schwarz function. And here I can use, so this is T, this is local T, TXZ. And here I can have Adelic T, and also here units. Here I can have also Adelic T. But in order to simplify things, I will just write it like this. And the measure on the multiplicative group is defined, of course, Adelic measure on things like this is the tensor product of multiplicative measure on two-dimensional local fields, and that one was defined before. So this is something which is very, very important because this will give us an integral representation for zeta functions of arithmetic surfaces. The first time that we will have an integral representation for the zeta function. Integral representations are hugely important from analytic point of view because if you have an integral representation, you can really derive many, many, many properties. So a concrete example, as usual, will be if we take f as tensor product of characteristic functions of local integral structures like this, and then also you need to do something right at Archimedean data if you have Archimedean data, but I just do not specify it. They will be related with Gaussian exponentials. So for this, the zeta integral will be, you just do the computation for elliptic surface. So from now on, I just talk about elliptic surfaces. We have the theory for arbitrary relative surfaces, but from now on, I'll just concentrate on elliptic surfaces which correspond to models of elliptic curves over global fields. So then many factors nicely converge, almost always equal to one. And the zeta integral, this zeta integral will be nicely equal to the zeta function of the surface at S, squared because two components, naturally squared. Then a certain number which is related to the conductor of the elliptic curve. And then also remember that we involve here in the definition, when I was defining analytic Adels, I said we have to involve finitely many horizontal curves, not infinitely, but finitely many. So this comes from vertical data. This comes from vertical data involved in the definition of analytic Adels. But we have finitely many horizontal data, and we can make sure that for horizontal data, this will be just one-dimensional zeta functions actually at S over 2, completed and squared. So this will be horizontal data. So on the horizontal data, there is some different normalization which results in S being replaced by S over 2. But then, of course, the one-dimensional zeta function satisfies the functional equation S goes to 1 minus S, and when you go from S to S over 2, they will satisfy the functional equation S goes to 2 minus S. So also if we have Archimedean data, then of course here there will be hidden finitely many gamma factors corresponding to the Archimedean points of horizontal curves. So this will also give us some nice convergent factor for this. But up to this, this is one-dimensional factors. This is something very simple. Substantially, the zeta integral is this. And so this is very nice because then we can study the zeta function or the square of the zeta function as the zeta integral. And the zeta integral has this nice adelic integral representation, so we can use, as usual, Fubini theorem if we have it, and we will have it when needed, and also the structure of this adelic space and its subquotients to do computations with this zeta integral and derive results about the zeta function of elliptic surface and hence about the L function of elliptic curve over global fields. So this is all very well understood and published and developed in many other directions. So now I will discuss what does it give to us. For example, we had two adelic dualities, geometric adelic duality and this theory, and Riemann-Roch. And we have analytic duality, or not duality, but something close to duality. And so what does it all tell us about this zeta integral? So it's more or less clear we have to use both dualities because it's two-dimensional situation. So just using one duality, for example, analytic duality, won't be enough because it's two-dimensional situation. You have to use all the information available at the level of adelis. So how do we do the computation? So this is like the first computation, just using the definition, adelic definitions of the zeta integral. But how can we do so-called second computation of this zeta integral using some kind of analog of Poisson summation formula, but in dimension two? So this Poisson summation formula is also called theta formula. It was called theta formula by Iwasawa. So we'll have now two-dimensional theta formula, which we'll use to compute this zeta integral. So this two-dimensional theta formula is a very delicate thing. There are many underlying difficulties hidden, but I don't have time to discuss. But I will mention some of them. So first of all, we'll use, of course, this filtration similar to how global elements sit inside adels and edels. We'll use this in dimension two. And so then we need also measure integration on B times B, multiplicative. And this is a little tricky. As I said, often you do something for finitely many curves, and then you go to the limit. So here we'll just take any finite subset of the set of all curves and tend it to the full set of the curves, so all vertical curves and finitely many horizontal curves. But this is finite subset of curve. And then for finite subset of curve, we have nicely convergent things. And in particular, here we'll have tensor product of measures on multiplicative spaces like this. And then the question is, what is this? So it is a little non-trivial due to various considerations of convergence. It's not counting measure anymore. In dimension one, that would be just the measure on the multiplicative group of global field. But of course, it's countable, so it's just usual counting measure on atomic measure in dimension one. In dimension two, things become more interesting. So this is actually, you need some normalization factor, which is like this. And then just the lift of counting measure from the residue field. The residue field will be Ky, which is discrete field. So this is a lift of counting discrete measure on global on this just usual classical one-dimensional global field. But because of this factor, interesting things happen. because here we'll tend to finitely many curves to all curves, then this factor will accumulate. So this measure is already very far away from the measure on the additive group. It's already very far away from this measure. In dimension one, they are the same. In dimension two, they are very different from each other. The multiplicative B-space measure becomes really very, very different. And then we have two-dimensional Sito formula, which is a very delicate thing, because if you do something incorrectly, things collapse. They start to stop to converge. So two-dimensional Sito formula. So one of the best ways to write it down is like this. Start with a function f, which is like nice function characteristic, tensor product characteristic functions of integral structures of rank 2, or something like this. And then also, by definition, I denote by f alpha a function which at beta equals to f alpha beta. It's just to simplify formulas, where alpha is some ideal, or ideal in like this. So then I can write down that formula in a nice shape. And I will explain why it looks like it, as it looks. So this is an integral over the multiplicative, this and this. And this will be equal to the integral over the so-called weak boundary of the same B space. So in dimension one, this is a multiplicative group of global field. And in dimension one, this is just zero, edit zero. And you compare the integral over the multiplicative group with zero because you know that the integral over the additive group you have for some summation formula, Sito formula, which makes things vanish. So this is a formula. So the point is that, for example, on the left-hand side and on the right-hand side, this integral is not equal to the integral of this and then minus the integral of this. So it's a more delicate thing. You have to involve the difference inside the integral, and this integral won't be equal to the difference of the integrals, and similarly on the right-hand side. There are various convergence issues which force you to do that. And then the proof of this formula goes by as the limit of formulas for finitely many curves. For finitely many curves, you just lift Poisson summation formulas on each curve, and you check that everything is compatible with each other, and then you go to the limit. So this is like the limits. So these are the limits of one-dimensional Sito formulas, if you wish, when you increase the number of curves involved. And most of those limits will just collapse. They will diverge. But these limits and this limit will survive. And then they give you this formula. So anyway, this is a two-dimensional Sito formula. And now we'll apply it to compute the zeta integral. And we'll get something nice. So similar to dimension one, we'll now have like analog of Tate-Vasava formula, which is that the zeta integral equals to the sum of two entire functions at s and 2 minus s. And this is the same entire function. For appropriately centrally normalized function f. Otherwise, the second will be different from the first, centrally normalized f. And plus something else, omega s, which I call boundary term, the boundary term, because it will correspond to the boundary. It will correspond to this boundary. So this is the boundary term. In dimension one, remember the boundary term had pole at 0 and 1, which corresponded to the fact that the boundary was 1 point, 0. But in dimension two, this boundary is huge. It's infinite space. It's not just 0. And then this boundary term will have infinitely many poles. So this boundary term with infinitely many poles, which will be also poles of the zeta integral, and therefore of the zeta function, and therefore there will be zeros of the L function. So this term, via its poles and its integral representation as integral, will know about zeros of the L function, which is a huge deal for people working in conventional arithmetic geometry and analytic number theory. So what is this boundary term? Well, it's similar to the one-dimensional thing. So it just comes as the result of using this quotient filtration and then replacing the internal integral like this by this. So the internal integral we just replace by the boundary because it simplifies things substantially. And then here you have those things which are similar to this. And then, of course, you have also something depending on S. So it's kind of complicated expression. It can be rewritten in many different ways, of which maybe the easiest will be like this. So if you just rearrange terms, it can be written like a classical calculus integral of this shape. So it's integral from 0 to 1 of a certain function, which has adelic integral representation, and this. And so we just need to study this. By the way, I can also make change of variable n equals to e to the power of minus t, and then I come to Laplace transform. This is Laplace transform. So Laplace transform really is used in analytic number theory. Usually people say half Mellin transform, but or Mellin transform. But Mellin transform is exactly Laplace transform. So anyway, this is the result of the second computation of the zeta integral. And now one may ask various kinds of questions, like in dimension one, after we compute the zeta integral, we get meromorphic continuation, functional equation, and various other things. So what about analog of that in dimension two? Well, the boundary term is more complicated in dimension two, so we have to study the boundary term. In dimension one, it was just basically degenerating. It was just integral over 1 point. Nothing interesting. The answer comes immediately. In dimension two, of course, it's much more interesting because the integral will have infinitely many poles. So if we look at this, so this tells us that the boundary term is the Laplace transform of this function or something like this, up to something coming from here. So one can ask natural question, in which case the Laplace transform of a function has meromorphic continuation and functional equation? And remember that this function will satisfy some functional equation like this, something like this, because of this adelic integral representation. So in other words, I can rewrite it like Laplace transform of a certain function, I don't know, r, t, like this, and up to some shift, we can think about r as, for example, so this is a minus sign, as odd function. So it's a problem from calculus from classical real analysis, for which odd functions the Laplace transform is symmetric function. So symmetricity of the Laplace transform exactly will correspond to the functional equation s goes to 2 minus s. So say we have an odd function, an odd function, well, any odd function, for example, t. And then we start computing this. So this is odd function. We start to compute its Laplace transform. In this case, you compute explicitly, and of course you know that this will be a symmetric function of S. And then you look at the table of Laplace transforms for engineers, and you see that you always get from odd functions even functions when you compute Laplace transforms. But this function is maybe a little more complicated than a function which engineers meet. But still, so what are conditions on this function or this function? So that its Laplace transform is symmetric up to shift, and then automatically has functional equation and meromorphic continuation. And then the zeta integral will have, and then the zeta function will have, and then the L function will have. So what are conditions? So this was a long story. I kept asking all people who I can get grasp of working in analysis, and nobody knew the answer. And I could not understand why. Such a natural question from the point of view of first year undergraduate student who studies Laplace transforms. Like, you know, you notice that the Laplace transform of odd function is always even or symmetric function. But what does it mean? For which functions this is true? So I asked so many people. So basically now I understand a lot about people working in analysis. But then I remembered that I once was a student of high school, specialized high school in mathematics and physics attached to Leningrad University. And there I had some friends with whom I went to participate in mathematical Olympiads. So Perelman was not a student of that school, but he also participated, but he came from another school. But I had one friend who already for many years professor in university which is just next to Lumini, or maybe Lumini is on its campus. So he's professor there, and it happened that he actually is one of the world experts on this kind of questions. And there are like many thick books about this, and this is all very non-trivial. So we now know basically an equivalent condition when this Laplace transform has symmetric properties. And so these are all reduced to a certain thing which is called mean periodicity. So this is purely analytic theory, but we need it for number theory, for this computation. This is called mean periodicity. So what is mean periodicity? Mean periodicity was initially invented by one of founding members of the Bourbaki group, whose name was Delsarte. And so a function is called mean periodicity is generalization of periodicity. So, for example, a function is called mean periodic. A function, an element of some space, some functional space, say L, is called mean periodic if its convolution with an element of non-zero element of the dual space is zero. So an element of original functional space is called mean periodic if there is non-zero element of the dual space. Non-zero element of the dual space such that the convolution, in functional analysis you can compute, convolution is the integral. convolution is zero. Or alternatively, a function is called mean periodic if when you consider its additive shifts, then the space generated by the additive shifts, shifted function, is not dense. Is not dense in L. So mean periodic functions like they satisfy something which prevents them and their shifts to be everywhere dense in L. So there is some still internal restriction on how they can behave. Of course, usual periodic functions are mean periodic. But mean periodicity is a more general property than usual periodicity. By the way, there is also almost periodicity, but it's different. So anyway, this mean periodicity was studied by such people as Schwartz, and actually he also developed, it's related with his theory of distributions and stuff like that. And then it was studied by such people as vice-chancellor, president of one of Paris universities, and a communist with this name. So Kahan, and it was studied by various other people, including, by the way, Lux, and so on. So anyway, depending on what functional space is, we have a well-developed theory of mean periodic functions or not so well-developed theory of mean periodic functions. Also, mean periodic functions supposed to have generalized Fourier series representation. Generalized Fourier series representation means that you can express in the topology of that functional space a function as convergent series may be grouped appropriately of exponential functions times polynomials. So these are not just constants as for usual Fourier series, but in general they are polynomials. So you allow polynomials as coefficients, not necessarily constants. And these polynomials know about the multiplicity of the Laplace transform. So in the case of this, they will know about multiplicity of zeros of L function. So after we learned about this theory, then we started to search which functional space would be suitable. And finally, we found that what that space is. So the answer then here, the answer on the first question, which is, what can we say about meromorphic continuation and functional equation from the point of view of the theory? The answer then is given by the following theorem, that taking into account all the series, the zeta function of elliptic surface has meromorphic continuation and functional equation. If and only if this function h e minus t is a mean periodic function in the space of smooth functions of not more than exponential growth on the real line. So this space is smooth functions of not more than exponential growth at plus minus infinity. Not more than exponential growth means that you still allow growth like this, but you do not allow growth like, for example, like this. So this kind of asymptotic growth is still allowed, but not that one. So we now have sufficient, we have an equivalent condition. When zeta functions and L functions of elliptic curve have meromorphic continuation functional equation, from the point of view of the theory, we need this analytic property to be satisfied that it's mean periodic function in this space. So roughly speaking, engineers, they mostly work with mean periodic functions, and then, of course, for them, Laplace transform of odd function is always symmetric function. And also, the substance of this theorem and this approach is that in number theory, we do not get this kind of functions when we studied zeta functions. So this kind of things cannot show up here. And so this is a theorem. But we still don't know if we don't have yet a proof that this function is a mean periodic function in this space. We only can easily deduce that if elliptic curve is automorphic, then yes, this function is of course mean periodic. But still, there are some analytic problems to follow the Adelic computation and to deduce that this function is mean periodic in this space. And amazingly, some very important results which underlie the proof of the theorem were established only very recently, like 2010, by people working in functional analysis who have no idea about all this development or anything in number theory. They just established certain results about related to mean periodicity in these spaces very, very recently, 2010. It's modern harmonic analysis, whereas, for example, moduli and automorphic functions use essentially very elementary analytic theory of the 19th century. But this theory of mean periodic functions uses very modern harmonic analysis, which is very, very recent. So it's the first time that such advanced part of modern analysis, like harmonic analysis, is related with properties of zeta and L functions from the point of view of this theory. Okay, so finally, I will discuss another related issue, which is because this is some information about zeta functions of elliptic curves. For them, we have several fundamental problems, not only meromorphic continuation in functional equation, but also the generalized Riemann hypothesis and the BSD. So if to tell very briefly about generalized Riemann hypothesis, there is also a lot of work done. In particular, by the way, this was a joint work with Masatoshi Suzuki from Tokyo Institute of Technology. And Guillaume Ricotta from Bordeaux. And also, I already said that it uses some modern harmonic analysis, but, well, believe it or not, it also uses some modern tools from modern analytic number theory, like convexity bounds. So without them, I alone would not be able to prove anything like this, because I am not really a great expert in convexity bounds in modern analytic number theory. So this is a very serious theorem. Now, for generalized Riemann hypothesis, again, there are various results and also computations. And again, some of them done by Masatoshi Suzuki. So here the situation is very interesting, because generalized Riemann hypothesis is about zeros of L function, but the L function is the denominator for the zeta function. So the generalized Riemann hypothesis becomes about poles of the zeta function and the zeta integral. But this zeta integral has integral representation. It has integral representation. So in analysis, it's much easier to tell something about poles of integrally represented function than about its zeros. This is why we still have no success with the Riemann hypothesis in dimension one, because in dimension one, we do not have any good integral representation for one over the Riemann zeta function, so that we would study the poles instead of zeros. We only have integral representation for the zeta function, for the completed zeta function, but it's difficult to combine it with the study of zeros. But in dimension two, we have on one hand integral representation, which comes from this theory, and on the other hand, generalized Riemann hypothesis becomes a property of the poles. There are infinitely many poles, which is some kind of difficulty, but at least analytically, unlike topologically or arithmetic geometrically, it's easier to study poles than zeros. For example, in Delin's proof for generalized Riemann hypothesis, it does not matter zeros or poles, because it's algebraic proof, algebraic geometric proof. But as soon as you deal analytically, to study pulse is much easier. So really my expectation is that this two-dimensional generalized Riemann hypothesis for elliptic curves using this theory will be established definitely earlier than the one-dimensional Riemann hypothesis, which is out of reach by using any of existing methods. And there is already a lot of work done by Masatoshi Suzuki or jointly with him. So we have equivalent reformulation. What does the generalized Riemann hypothesis mean for this data integral in terms, again, of this function h? And unlike dimension one, there are better convergence of this integral. And in particular, there is some Polyas method to study generalized Riemann hypothesis, which does not work in dimension one, but which works in dimension two. So roughly speaking, but this is imprecisely subject to certain restrictions, roughly speaking, the fourth derivative of this function should be positive, should keep its sign when going to infinity. So it's, which means that the third derivative will be monotone when going to infinity. So if this property holds, generalized Riemann hypothesis follows, essentially, up to various other small technical things which are of subsidiary nature. So we have basically already a reformulation of generalized Riemann hypothesis in terms of analytic properties of this function. It's just the fourth derivative, the fourth because 2 plus 2. 2 is, shows up everywhere here. So we just need that the fourth derivative of this function, and this function comes from modelic integration, it keeps its sign. So if we can prove this, we'll have the proof of generalized Riemann hypothesis, but we don't, of course, yet have this property. And finally, BSD, which from my point of view is the most interesting application of this theory, because it really kind of explains what's going on with what is really BSD about. Because in its original statement, you don't really see what it is about. But from this point of view, from the point of view of this theory, you really see structures interacting. And so from the point of view of this theory, the rank part of BSD, which compares analytic and geometric ranks, or analytic and arithmetic ranks of elliptic curve, it's a certain relation between two adelic structures on the surface. So at least the rank part of BSD over any field, local, global characteristic zero, or global and positive characteristic, does not matter. The rank part of BSD is just about relation between geometric analytic adels and geometric adels. And so let me just sketch how to get the equality in the BSD conjecture. So in fact, this is not difficult to explain at the level of ideas and concepts. So we are talking about the pole at the central point, s equal to 1, of the boundary term, because these are entire anyway. So we just, zero of L function is the same as pole of the boundary term. So we need to do some computation with the boundary term, using its representation in this form. And we're only interested at the central point. At the central point, by various reasons, it's easy to do computations. So then we need more information about this. So this is the boundary. If we can get hold of the structure of this boundary, Then we can split this integral into the product of some other integrals, substitute in this, and then we'll get a representation for this as the product of other integrals, and hopefully we can compute the pole at s equal to 1 of each of the factors. So we need more information about this. And when you look at it like this, you don't see how you can get more information about this. It's infinite space, the boundary is infinite, and it's not obvious at all how to get more information. But then you can use explicit class field theory and all these underlying definitions. And that B diagram, which I already wrote before, so that was this modulo units times this modulo units, and then continuous map. And then surjective to K2TB. And so if we want to get some information about the boundary of this space, because this map is continuous, if we get some information at this level, we can translate it into information about this space. So we can use this vertical map. And then we need, what is the advantage of this? Because here we have adelic structures of two different types, geometric and analytic. Here we only have C analytic. But here we have some geometry involved, which kind of still preserved via this continuous map. So what kind of geometry? I already mentioned at the beginning that if you're interested in the Picard group, it is not seen by class field theory, but it is easily seen as relation between B second and bottom level. Namely, this is isomorphic to the Picard group of elliptic surface. This follows immediately from the definitions. So this component, it knows something about the geometry, it knows the Picard rank, it knows about the Picard group. And in particular, of course, for elliptic surfaces, we have old paper by Kodaira and then Tate and many other people. So we know the Picard group in terms of its generators. We know geometric generators of the Picard group. And these geometric generators come from irreducible from components of singular fibers. And then you have zero section. So you just take all components except one, which intersects zero section. Then you also take finitely many horizontal curves, which correspond to generators of Mordell Weil group of the generic fiber. And they will be more or less generators of this Picard group. So we know generators here. This is just classical theory. So we can use then the fact then. Because of this, we will know this space. So it will be then the image of this and this the product of this generators corresponding to these curves. So maybe I should write BYI. But finitely many spaces involved here. So we'll a modulo units. So we can use this fact for this component, which is geometrical component. And then if we can trace the image of this data to this level, where geometry kind of disappears because it's only analytic adels, then we can get information about this space and its boundary. And then when you start to unravel this, you see that it goes exactly what I said. So because we have this split into the product, then we'll have split by continuity of this space into the product of spaces, and then the whole integral, if we are only interested in the computation of the pole at the central point, the whole integral then, as far as the pole at s equal to 1 is concerned, the whole integral then will reduce the study of the pole to the product of one-dimensional integrals over these curves. at s equal to 1. And each of them will have pole of order 1 on vertical. And on horizontal, it will be... Well, to simplify, I say vertical and horizontal. So on this finitely many generators of the Picard group, plus also some contribution from K. So it's important not to forget from contribution from K, because K is still here. Now, units do not contribute because integrals just do not have poles over units. So here we'll get from each curve exactly pole of order 2. So from the total contribution of this will give us exactly twice of analytic rank, of geometric rank, of Picard rank. And of course, here we are interested in analytic rank, but because zeta integral is the square of the zeta function, it will be twice of analytic rank of the L function. So 2 will cancel with 2, and we'll get analytic rank equals to the geometric rank. Or if you wish, analytic rank equals to the arithmetic rank. So this is exactly the statement of Birchin-Swinnerton-Dyer conjecture, the rank part. Provided we can control this term. So we still have to control this term. We need to do something with the contribution from global functions. And it's kind of non-trivial contribution, because first it comes to this geometric adels, and then via that continuous map, but which is not really very explicit. But via that continuous map, it gives us some contribution to this space, and we need to compute integral over that contribution and check that it doesn't contribute another zero or pole. So the current state of activity with this evaluation of the contribution from the global element is that in positive characteristic, we can use the Riemann-Roch theorem. When I was describing the Riemann-Roch theorem in positive characteristic, I said that it follows from a Adelic representation of the intersection pairing. And in particular, I mentioned that global elements sit discretely in geometric adels. So global elements are discrete in geometric adels. So this immediately implies that the multiplicative group is discrete also in the space B multiplicative. So in the positive characteristic case, global elements will sit here discretely, and this will imply that the integral of the image over global elements won't contribute zeros or poles, because the space is too small. It's not enough size to accumulate zeros or poles, at least not enough size to accumulate poles, because the space is too small. So in positive characteristics, then this actually implies not the equality, but the inequality relating analytic rank and geometric rank. Contribution from this can still have zero, but at least it won't have a pole. So this will mean that analytic rank does not exceed the geometric rank. But in positive characteristics, the opposite inequality was already known like for 50 years, that the geometric rank does not exceed the analytic rank. So together with this, this gives the full equality in characteristic P. So this is in characteristic P, and it's included in my paper, which is already was written 5 years ago. So in characteristic P, the situation is much simpler. But in characteristic zero, we still need to do a lot of work. For example, first of all, we still don't know if K is a discrete subspace of geometric adels. So this is related to adelic interpretation of Arakelov geometry on elliptic surfaces. It's an associated activity to show that the global functions are discrete in geometric adels on elliptic surfaces, elliptic arithmetic surfaces. As I said, this is being written down, but it has not yet been written down to the extent that it's a paper. So still we need more work. More work with this, and then more work how you use this to show that the contribution from the analog of the global elements but in characteristic zero does not give us a pole. So in characteristic zero still a lot of work to be done, but at least from conceptual point of view we now understand much better the substance of Burchin-Swinton-Dye conjecture. So this geometry and, if you wish, arithmetic rank of elliptic curve over global field, it comes from the Picard group, which is closely related to the geometric adels, to dimensional geometric adels, which is this term. And then this diagram comes from explicit class field theory, and the zeta integral lives here, or part of it lives here. So therefore, to relate the analytic rank with arithmetic rank means just to trace how these two adelic structures, geometric and analytic, how they interact in this diagram and how the zeta integral computes on the image of the global elements. So to expect that global elements sit discretely in adels, it's very natural. This property, of course, in dimension one, it's classical property. Global functions always, global elements always discrete in adels. So, and in two dimension, we know this in characteristic P, but of course, it is most natural to expect it will be true in characteristic zero as well. So from this point of view, in some sense, using this theory, we already have kind of reduction of the rank part of Burchin-Swinton-Dye conjecture to some much more natural property which we can expect holds. But still, work is ongoing and we'll see how it goes. Finally, in the last 4 minutes of this series of lectures, I wanted to tell something about relation of this with IUT. So it may sound very strange that I want to relate this with IUT, but in fact, there are various analogies between these two adelic structures and IUT. So at the beginning of my lectures, I was talking about class field theory and its three generalizations, which were higher class field theory, the Langlands program, and Abelian geometry. So these generalizations are very different from each other. And then from higher class field theory, you come to this adelic analysis geometry and zeta integrals. From Abelian geometry, you come to IUT. So today I try to emphasize how important is the interaction between two adelic structures on elliptic surfaces, and that there are these two different structures. One is geometric adelis, and for geometric adelis, the key thing is geometric duality on the additive group, and the Riemann-Roch theory, and discreteness of global elements. So here we work with the additive group. So this is geometric additive symmetry. On the other hand, when we compute the zeta integral, then we work with arithmetic or analytic adels corresponding to zero cycles. And we work with the multiplicative group because the zeta integral lives on the product of two copies of the multiplicative group. So this is multiplicative and this is additive. And in IUT, there are two fundamental symmetries which I used. And one is geometric additives, and also for elliptic curves over number fields, again. One is geometric additive symmetry. So these are symmetries in IUT. And another multiplicative arithmetic symmetry. Multiplicative symmetry. So, you know, the combination of words corresponds to each other, there and there. But of course, the way how the symmetry is defined in IUT, no two-dimensional adels show up anywhere. But from this point of view and various others, I don't have time to mention, it seems natural to expect that actually there should be some more general structures than adelic structures, and those symmetries as they defined in IUT, which then connect these two and these two. And in particular, as I emphasized today, a relation between geometric adels and arithmetic adels is very important, in particular for computation of ranks of elliptic curves. So on the other hand, in IUT, interaction between these two symmetries is already there. It's just part of the whole picture. Various relations between these two symmetries are already there in IUT. Here we only want to uncover them. And we still are in the process of doing that. But in IUT there are already many relations between these two symmetries. So therefore, because of this, and if we can understand better these links, this may potentially help us to see more about this and then have more applications to special values of L functions. So this is very, very briefly, but there are many other aspects of IUT and this two-dimensional adelic theory which look often strikingly similar to each other, even though there is no rational explanation why, because originally they came from very different perspectives. So anyway, this is what I was planning to include in my lectures. Thank you very much for your attention. If you have any solutions of any problems or any questions, please contact me either directly, because I am here till August 14, and then for 3 months in the autumn, or indirectly by sending me email. Thank you.